Initially, punk rock was not profitable. Though it may save your life, seldom did it pay the bills. The music was brash, loud, and rarely ever played on the radio. But Nirvana and grunge changed that in 1991. Unlike the classic rock, metal-indebted versions of grunge peddled by Pearl Jam and Alice in Chains, Nirvana's version was a slick collision of Black Flag and the Beatles, a punk-metal-pop hybrid previously unheard of by the mainstream public. But as Nirvana bassist Krist Novoselic once said in an interview, it was nothing new. Hüsker Dü did it before us. Few bands summed up the pre-grunge alternative rock scene in the 1980s, like Minneapolis's Hüsker Dü. Their name came from a Danish board game that guitarist-songwriter Bob Mould recalled from his youth, ironically translated as "Do You Remember?" Starting as an underground hardcore band, they transformed into what we know today as alternative rock, a sound that would attract the attention of radio stations, major labels, and the masses. The musical groundwork they put in their 9 years of existence paved the way for the 90s alt-rock takeover. But who were Hüsker Dü? Why were they so important? And how did they give birth to alternative rock? Before they were Hüsker Dü, the band were named Buddy and the Returnables, formed in 1979. After a few live performances playing solely covers with a keyboardist, Charlie Pine, the band started rehearsing Ramones-inspired originals without Pine's knowledge. Hüsker Dü's first official performance was on March 30th, 1979, where after several covers, the band launched into their searing double-time originals, much to Pine's confusion. His keyboard was unplugged midway through the performance, leaving Hüsker Dü forevermore as a trio. Guitarist-vocalist Bob Mould, drummer-vocalist Grant Hart, and bassist Greg Norton. Fueled by a bit too much amphetamine, their debut live album, Land Speed Record, was released in 1982, packing 17 songs into 26 and a half minutes. It was powerfully fast, but with a hint of melody that set them apart from the hardcore bands they frequently played shows with.
You know, initially, we're like, yeah, let's play faster than the Ramones. And then we heard the Dickies, and it's like, well, let's play faster than the Dickies. You know, I always like to say that Hüsker was the hardcore punk band that you could whistle their tunes.
Their debut studio album, Everything Falls Apart, released the next year, is similarly fast, with the title track being the only real let-up. This, along with their relentless touring and live reputation, got the band signed to SST, the independent label of Black Flag guitarist Greg Ginn, home to other influential 80s acts like the Meat Puppets, Minutemen, and later Sonic Youth and the Descendants. Hüsker Dü's first release on SST was their Metal Circus EP, which produced their first hit on college radio. College radio was a big contribution to the proliferation of alternative rock in the 1980s. During the late 1970s, student-run radio stations became a mainstay in college towns, not tied to playing the hits, like top 40 stations of the day. College radio became very popular due to its music choices, expanded beyond the mainstream. So this included European synth-pop, post-punk, and indie. As well as this new breed of American alternative rock. Tracks like Black Eye Blister in the Sun, Sorry, Take the Skinheads Bowling, became early hits within this format. And this is exactly what the replacement song Left of the Dial is about. Music that is off the beaten track, an alternative to the mainstream. College radio and their playlisting choices would be a precursor to the alt-rock centric stations of the 90s. The song of Metal Circus that got airplay on these college radio stations was Diane. Slower and more considered than the lightspeed punk of their earlier work, it told the true story of the murder of teenage waitress Diane Edwards, sung from the point of view of the killer, inspired by a news article Hart had read. Its morbid subject matter was an advancement in what hardcore bands could sing about, no longer just overtly political music. It was an evolution to hardcore music in the same way Eleanor Rigby was the next step for the Beatles, no longer singing about themselves and their experiences, but looking outward, having interest and empathizing with others outside their realm of understanding. Diane spread their music nationwide and beyond. Therapy from Northern Ireland, greatly inspired by Hüsker Dü, notably covered the song in 1995, replacing the serrated guitars with haunted cello work. In 1984, Hüsker Dü released what is considered their opus, Zen Arcade. On that album, the band moved from being a hardcore band with a head for melody to something that is much more recognisable as alternative rock. It may be abrasive and heavy in parts, but most importantly, it's tuneful enough that it can be appreciated by people other than the punk kids. There's the hardcore thrash of Mould's Broken Home, Broken Heart. And I'll Never Forget You. But there's also piano sections, psychedelic interludes, and more deeply emotional moments, mostly written by Hart, including album High Point, Pink Turns to Blue. And a solely acoustic track in the form of Never Talking to You Again. There are things that I'd like to say, but I'm never talking to you again. Their songwriting duality really becomes apparent on this album. Mould more brash and anguished, Hart more interested in pop melody. A Lennon-McCartney relationship for 80s punk. Zen Arcade is a concept album, the story of a young punk who leaves home and wrestles with whether to join the army, a cult, or get a job in video game design. On his journey, he finds and loses love before reaching his lowest point, realizing that he will never be able to change his situation, before then waking up, the whole journey being a dream. While not the first punk rock concept album, That's Life by Sham69 probably has that title. It would influence the more adventurous punks going forward. Fucked Up and Titus Andronicus' sprawling narratives owe a lot to Hüsker Dü. If you think the story of Zen Arcade sounds familiar, that is probably because elements of the story are taken by Green Day for their 2004 album American Idiots. Foo Fighters' Dave Grohl was also inspired by the album. In 1995, he said,
That album was amazing. I mean, Black Flag was early on, and then when I discovered Zen Arcade, I thought, God, these people write songs, man. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's amazing. It's like the Birds meets Black Flag, and it would just blew me away. And the songs just stuck in your head forever, and they're just amazing.
In the Village Voices, Jop and Paz End of Year Critics Album List in 1984, Zen Arcade appeared at number 8 amongst Bruce Springsteen and Prince. This gained Hüsker Dü a lot of attention, the small hardcore band being ranked alongside the biggest pop acts in America at the time, and led Warner Brothers to gain interest in potentially signing the band. This, combined with the many financial and distribution issues the band were having with SST, helped them make the decision. After flirting with the label throughout 1985, and after releasing two more albums, New Day Rising and Flip Your Wig, the band signed to them in 1986, in time to release Candy Apple Grey. Due to this, this was the first album to get significant play on MTV, increasing the exposure for the band to a new kind of audience. Hüsker Dü were questioned about the decision on the Joan Rivers show in 1987.
Are you getting knocks on this that you're coming up? Because you signed with Warner Brothers, which is a very big label now, right?
That's sometimes an excuse for people not to do anything, is to knock people who are...
Yeah.
With Candy Apple Grey, Hüsker Dü set an example by being one of the first bands from the American indie scene to sign to a major record label, which helped establish college rock as a viable commercial enterprise. Admittedly, they weren't the first 80s underground band to sign to a major label. The Replacements beat them to the punch slightly, being signed to Sire, a subsidiary of Warner Brothers, the previous year, in time for the release of Tim. After this, major labels started searching for their own Hüsker Dü or Replacements, critical college rock darlings that could potentially net them a new audience and revenue stream. The most successful of these signings was when Warner Brothers snapped up REM in 1988, before the release of Green, an album that went on to sell 4 million copies worldwide. Other alternative bands would be signed throughout the tail end of the decade, including Jane's Addiction, Faith No More, and Soundgarden. Most importantly, after having their Daydream Nation album distributed by Capitol, iconic No Waivers' Sonic Youth would sign to Geffen in 1990 to release Goo. After a recommendation from the band, Nirvana signed with the label in 91 for their big breakout success, Nevermind. Without Hüsker Dü paving the way for these other bands moving from independent labels, the grunge explosion of the early 1990s would not have happened. As Michael Azarad wrote in his book, Our Band Could Be Your Life, Hüsker Dü played a huge role in convincing the underground that melody and punk rock weren't antithetical. They took what was essentially hardcore punk and made it into something that could be played on the radio. The impact they had on the late 80s, early 90s alternative rock scene is incredible. Pixies bassist Kim Deal was famously recruited after responding to a classified ad requesting a female bassist who'd like both Peter, Paul and Mary and Hüsker Dü. As well as being influenced by the Pixies, Nirvana have stated Hüsker Dü's importance. In 96, Dave Grohl said, "When Nirvana became popular, people would ask me, what's the recipe for this new kind of music? And I'd think, gee, haven't you heard of Hüsker Dü? To me, it's sort of natural, playing loud, fast, melodic pop music. That's the kind of thing I've always loved." Dinosaur Jr. were also inspired by Hüsker Dü's distorted, melodic, alternative rock, even following their hero's footsteps by signing to Warner Brothers in 91. Former Dinosaur Jr. bassist Lou Barlow's later band, Subada, wrote a tongue-in-cheek tribute to them in Gimme Indie Rock, which, as well as name-checking noise rock band Pussy Galore, Sonic Youth, and his former band, features the line, "Hüsker Dü's sonic influence wasn't just on the alternative rock genre. On Don't Wanna Know If You're Lonely, Could You Be The One, and even as early as Pink Turns To Blue, their heart-and-sleeve lyricism served with a dollop of angst points a clear line to the 90s pop-punk explosion, especially to Green Day. It makes sense considering that their more romantically focused songs were an extension of the emotive punk rock created by the Buzzcocks, just with added hardcore punch. Just listen to Don't Wanna Know If You're Lonely's climatic lyrics, which could slot into any end-of-the-century power pop breakup song." Green Day even covered the song for the MTV show Influences in 2000. But the Huskers' impact didn't end there. Even Robert Palmer of Addicted to Love fame was a fan, covering New Day Rising as part of his live show in the late 80s. Also, with Mould being openly gay and Hart being openly bisexual, Hüsker Dü gave a lot of young punks representation within the music they love. Though, like the Buzzcocks' Pete Shelley before them, They made a point of not including gender pronouns in their love songs because they wanted to address universal experience. While rarely mentioned in the same breath as Nirvana, The Smashing Pumpkins or Sonic Youth, Hüsker Dü did a lot for alternative rock. Their mix of hardcore punk and pop music was an inspiration for some of the biggest bands of the 90s.
Welcome to paradise. They will give you nightmares for a week. I'm telling you goodbye.
They were one of the bands that made college radio the success that it was, making way for the alternative rock stations prevalent in the 90s. They were one of the first college rock bands to get a major record deal, making it possible for 90s alt-rock bands to become the mainstream-focused sensation that they were. Plus their songs. And albums are staples of the genre. Zen Arcade was ranked number 4 on Spin Magazine's list of the top 100 alternative music albums, ahead of Nirvana's Nevermind, REM's Murmur, Sonic Youth's Daydream Nation, and The Replacements' Let It Be. While there are other alternative rock bands that sold more records with more recognition, Hüsker Dü gave birth to the genre as we know it. You best remember that. Thanks for watching. What's your favorite forgotten alt-rock band? If you liked the video, like, comment, and subscribe. If you really liked it, check out my Patreon. There's some great rewards on there, including exclusive playlists, voting for future videos, and the chance to watch new videos early. I'd like to thank my top tier patrons, including brand new members, Federico Pascale and Lynn Darla. Thanks a bunch, and see you next time.